Okay, so we conducted a survey back in May 2017. It was a 44-question survey, so we would like to thank everyone who participated in the survey. There were 36 total people that we sent it out to, 36 countries, and we got a response of 29, 4 partially completed and 24 partially and 25 are completed. And thank you so much. The list of the countries who participated in the survey are to your right. It's a very good survey, I should say. Everybody is well represented, every region in the world. So we hope that we could learn more from each other during this meeting, and this survey will give us more of a framework or a guideline in terms of what are the most important things that we need to talk about. So the very first question that we asked everyone is, what are the topics that you would like to talk about during this meeting? What are the most important things to you as a country leader, as a representative of the patients? And when we looked at all the responses, we asked everyone to rank 10 topics from 1 to 10. What is the most important? 1 being the most and 10 being the least. And then we asked also what other topics that were not mentioned in the 10 that you would like to be covered in this meeting. And this is the summary. So the research and scientific updates is the most important that people ranked as number one. And access to GIST specialists is the next. Access to clinical trials, supporting patient needs, and then precision medicine or diagnostic tests such as mutational and plasma level testing. And the rest you can see in the graph. But this top five are what we went by in terms of framing the discussions for today. So this is just a highlight. As I've said, it's a 44-question survey. I don't want to go through the 44. So one of the most important, based on the previous slide, we asked if mutational testing is considered a standard of care in your country, and we have an overwhelming answer. 22 of the 29 who responded said that the mutational testing is not standard of care. And when we break it down by geography, the no are the red, and you can see the list of the countries. And I guess my takeaway from this survey is that we should learn from the folks who said yes, that this is a standard of care in their country. Oops, sorry. We need to understand how to get there. Even here in the United States, this is a struggle for us because the guidelines for treating patients with GIST doesn't say that it's a standard of care, it is recommended. So I hope the folks who are here today, if you are representing this country, please tell us how you got there. And we ask, how does a GIST patient go about finding a GIST specialist? This is an important part of the care of our patients. And the primary doctor who triage them to the cancer center is how they basically find the GIST specialist. And the other category that got the most answer is patients contact your organization, via email or phone for a recommendation. And that says a lot about the work that we do as patient advocates. And also the websites, your websites or other organizations' websites are the other source. So when we ask, what are the primary barriers and challenges to increasing patients' access to GIST specialists? Distance, a lot of you answered distance as the number one barrier, fear of offending current physician, and then the lack of just specialists in the country. I think it's very telling of the landscape of the problem that we have in terms of just specialists. If they're not there, then, or if we don't identify them, then that's a problem. If our culture is tells us that we can't go to another specialist because we will offend the other doctor, that is also something that we need to, cultural competence is important. And then the distance. I think that although this is a barrier or a challenge, I think this is something that we can explain to our patients that it's worth the travel. Getting to that specialist is always worth the time and the distance. So we asked accessibility of the current treatments that our patients have in their country, imatinib, sunitinib, and regorafenib. And as you can see in the graph, imatinib is easily accessible among the three. And if you compare, although they said that regorafenib is accessible, if you notice 14 responded that it is not easily accessible or not at all accessible. So accessibility for the third line is a challenge, but accessibility overall for sunitinib, for imatinib and sunitinib is good. And if we break it down by geography, we only listed the ones that we think we should put a lot of emphasis into, which is those who are not easily accessible and the not at all accessible. And these are the list of countries where I think we should put some focus or emphasis into helping one another get to get treatments access for our patients. When it comes to reimbursability, I think it's the same picture that we see. If the drug is not accessible, of course, it's not also reimbursable. But for the most part, I'm glad to see that imatinib for adjuvant and metastatic recurrent disease, sunitinib and regorafenib are actually reimbursed by the healthcare providers in the country. It's still a challenge, of course, for the third line regorafenib. And these are the countries where the drugs are not easily reimbursable or not at all reimbursable. You can see a pattern of why. In some countries, although they are developed countries, it's not available as a third line treatment. And of course, our representatives from Asia and in the Middle East have a lot of challenge in terms of reimbursability. So when we ask, to what extent do GIST patients in your country have access to clinical trials? This is another topic that is important to all of you, as you said, and overwhelmingly representatives said that in their country they do not have easy access to clinical trials. We've heard this story also over and over in many instances that we've counseled our patients that it is a challenge in two ways. The patients are not participating, there's no participation in clinical trials, and also in other countries, there are no clinical trials. So I think this is a work that we need to focus on also as a community. And these are the countries where, how they categorized the accessibility of clinical trials. I think there's we don't see a pattern here because we know that even in Canada, it's not an easy access. Still in the United States, not an easy access. Asia is mostly not, we do not have easy access. And what are the three most important things that patients care about in the management of GIST? This is the theme. You've answered this actually as a text or as an open-ended question. So what I did was I collated all your answers, and this is what I this is the theme that I got. Survival is of course the number one most important thing. Access to expert care and management of GIST or GIST specialist, access to GIST specialist, and then access to treatment. I think this too speaks loudly also about the number one answer. So what are the primary sources do GIST patients use and depend on for information about GIST? Their physicians. The internet actually, and the physicians are almost tied. And the patient advocacy groups also are the sources, and then other patients. So I think this slide will give us a bit of a framework of where we can focus our efforts in terms of who do we reach out to get the resources or the information to our patients. How significant is the issue of medication compliance or adherence with GIST patients in your country? If you notice, this was not an issue in the ranking of the most important topics that we need to discuss. But when we asked this as a separate question, we found out that it's actually a significant issue in your country. So we should add it to the ranking. the list of countries who answered this question in terms of how significant or the degree of significance is on the right here. In general, what are the previous ways you influence guidelines and policy for GIST? This is also an open-ended question. And what we did was we consolidated all your answers, and these are the top ways. So these are the top ways you influence guidelines and policy for GIST. Meeting with health authorities and regulatory bodies, lobbying government and private sectors, reporting events in the media, engaging healthcare providers and pharma communities, participating in broader campaigns with other patient groups, publications, and interact with and advocate for patients. Putting it in a perspective of who you need to influence, I think it's very obvious that we influence the patients a lot in terms of advocating for healthcare policy in our country. And the common theme came out of your, this is also an open-ended question, and the same theme came over and over, which is access to treatment, access to clinical trials, access to GIST, informing the patients. They are the theme that we saw in the survey. So Norman is going to give you the breakdown of the summary or the key findings.
A little bit differently. One of the things that I don't want to have happen at the end, how many people were with us at a great meeting that we had in Bovino? Anybody with us?
Bovino, Italy?
Bovino, Italy. David, great meeting, right? And at the end of the meeting in Bovino, we passed a declaration. Patient advocates from all over the country, all over the world, got together, and it's called the Bovino Declaration. By a show of hands, how many people in this room have ever seen the Bovino Declaration?
I've never seen.
Have never seen. How many people here have never seen the Bovino Declaration? Look around that. One more time. Never seen the declaration that the global community passed after everybody traveled thousands of miles to get to a particular location. So my charge to us is, if at the end of this meeting, all we do is pass a declaration, we're as bad as the doctors who are not doing mutational testing, as bad as the patients who can't take their tests, because what we think is important is coming to a meeting and passing a declaration. So let's make a vow, okay? If we're going to put in a declaration, let's put it into something that we really mean, something that we really intend to do.